Alright, so we just learned about model checkpointing and early stopping. Let's take a look at a concrete code example. Again, like always, since we are working with a new dataset here, we will be starting with a preamble and inspect our dataset.
So in this notebook, we are going to inspect the dataset first, and then in the next notebook, we are going to train a model using checkpointing as discussed in the slides. And yeah, as you might know, first comes my favorite watermark package so that I can track the version numbers of the software libraries we are using, and that I can also make sure we are in the right Conda environment. So let's execute that code. And as we are seeing here, we are using the latest Lightning library as of this recording, and we are in our DL fundamentals Conda environment, which looks good. So then we are going to load the dataset. So let me make a header here. And we are using a toy dataset I created specifically for that lecture. So there is this custom data module that we are importing from the shared utilities file. So if you run this notebook, you have to make sure that shared utilities file here is in the location next to the notebook. So here we have all the utilities we are going to use. And here's this custom dataset. So it's just a dataset from, let's say, a random number generator that I am using here. But since we already discussed data modules in Unit 5, let's move on to the more interesting part. We are setting it up here. And then we are taking a quick look at the different sizes. We are taking a look at the training, validation, and test set sizes. So we have 14,400 data points for training, 1,600 data points for validation, and 4,000 data points for testing. Like you know, I like to check the label distribution because this way we can make sure or get a better understanding of how balanced the data set is. So let's do this. And I'm using the code that I used already in previous lectures, where we are essentially using the counter object from Python and then count how many instances there are per label. So we can see here for the training, we have two different labels, 0 and 1. So it's a binary classification task with almost a 50-50 ratio of class 0 and class 1. So it's a pretty balanced data set. And yeah, we can see the same is true for the validation and the test label set as well. Now, it's always a good idea to implement a baseline. So we are going to implement a zero rule baseline here. So let me type this out as a headline here. So zero rule baseline. And this is essentially a majority classifier. So our zero rule baseline essentially refers to a majority classifier that gives us the performance if we were always predicting the majority class. So in this case, the majority class would be class 0 because we have slightly more examples from class 0 compared to class 1. So if we use such a majority rule classifier, we can see we would get a almost 51% accuracy when we are always predicting the majority class. Why is that useful? In this case, well, it tells us if we implement a classifier, it should at least perform better than this baseline. Otherwise, we are doing something wrong. So it's a good thing to double check. All right, lastly, let's do a quick visual check. Since it's not an image data set, we don't have any images we can display here, but we can at least check the dimensions of the different vectors just to make sure everything looks as expected. And for that, we are going to take a look at the features here. So the features in the data loaders. So let's just grab one of those and use the .shape attribute. So we can see it's a mini batch of size 32 with 100 features here. So why is that 32? That's because it's the default setting in our data module here. So when I look here, we defined batch size 32 as the default, but we can of course change that. So where it's used is here in the training data loader. But of course, this is an arbitrary number that I've chosen for this example. The more interesting part here is that each data point consists of 100 features. So let's take a look at these features. We can essentially just index into this vector here. So we can see each feature vector consists of small numbers around zero, negative numbers and positive numbers. So it's looking like the data is already normalized. So personally, I have to say I made sure of that. But in a real case scenario, it's always a good idea also to check whether the data looks normalized, that the values are not too large and not too small.
Our goal is to implement early stopping or saving the best model during training. And in this video, we looked at the new data set that we will be working with. In the next video, we will then finally implement this model saving procedure.